You have a train to catch.
Parental Advisory, Slavic Content. Spider-Man No Way Home is the 27th installment of the MCU and it's the third film of the Tom Holland Spidey trilogy. Call me crazy, but usually the third film is the worst one of every fucking trilogy. Now here comes this film, with all this hype built around it. I thought it would never manage to meet expectations. That it would succumb and crumble under the pressure, and yet it delivered everything the fans were anticipating, and more than that. Beautifully done. Now the film begins right where Far From Home left us, with Mysterio revealing Spider-Man's true identity to the public and framing him for his murder. As a result, it destroys Peter's life and everyone else's that he holds dear, because our hero finds himself as a controversial public figure. At last, he manages to clear up his name of Mysterio's murder in the court of law thanks to Matthew Murdock. And boy oh boy, who did see that one coming?
I'm blind.
No shit!
Rejoice, fellow Netflix and Daredevil Charlie Cox fans, Lord Feige has heard and answered our prayers. The Devil of Hell's Kitchen is officially part of the MCU and we get to witness the Hornhead and our webslinger on the big screen for the first time in history together. Mwah! Beautiful. Anyways, even though Petty is proven innocent of the crime, the controversy still follows him, resulting in him and his friends being rejected from entering every university in the States. Петя, feeling guilty over his friend's demise due to being associated with him, grows desperate. So he does the logical thing. He pays a visit to the good doctor. He goes to the doctor and asks him to brainwash the world's entire population in order to make everyone forget Spider-Man's true identity. In short, Strange accepts to aid Петя, but during the spell, Петя sets different parameters so that not everyone forgets his identity, which ends up tampering with the spell and releases villains that knew his identity from different universes. So to manage this mess and bring order to the multiverse, Strange tasks Peter and his friends to bring the intruding guests from the other universes to his dungeon, with the intention of sending them back where they came from. Ultimately, the gang manages to accomplish to
Scooby-Doo this crap.
But once the villains start discussing their imminent fate, Petya finds out that they all end up dying by the hands of Spider-Man himself. Naturally, our hero's consciousness and sense of guilt kicks in, and he proceeds to free them by fighting and entangling Doctor Strange in the mirror dimension. After that, he proceeds to lead the said villains to where Aunt May, Happy, and he resides, in order to have a go at curing their villainy. I mean, what can go wrong, right? Well, pretty much everything. A word of advice. Never invite strangers to your house that came from a parallel universe, especially after finding out that they met their end by an alternate version of you. But what do I know? The whole thing went tits up once Norman's goblin persona resurfaces and rallies the rest of the villains to escape. An epic fight breaks out between Norman and Petya, which results in Aunt May's death at the very end of it. And this is the first catalyst that gives Holland Spider-Man some substantial character development. Wait now, put your pitchforks down. And no, I don't think that Iron Man's death did anything for his character to grow. And no matter how much they tried to sell it to me, in Far From Home, I never bought it. Sorry, not sorry. To summarize, the whole Petya growing up through his struggles in this film, the world keeps on punching him and trying to bring him down and tear him apart. But he sticks to his values and virtues is beautiful. So back to the main plot. Petya isolates himself to heal and realize the consequences that formed from his actions. Meanwhile, Ned and MJ are searching for him through Strange's mystical portal artifact. They open the first portal. look, it's Andrew. Not the one we wanted. Open the next one! Yes, now we're talking. Stop the research, we found him, the one and only Peter Parker. Now this is the part where everybody loses their shit. To be frank, seeing them together gave me chills. Felt like fan service, but done well. Good job, Marvel. The fact that both characters were essential to the story and Tom Holland's character development, it left me relieved. They didn't bring them back just to get a fanfic made on the big screen. Can't give them enough credit for that. The two Spider-Men aid Ned and MJ in finding their Peter. Once they locate him, they try to approach his emotional current state by sharing their own personal experiences. After some bonding, our heroes conclude that they need to make preparations for the final big battle. We get to witness various interactions we never knew we needed, with the cherry on top being the web shooters interaction between the three webheads. The way everyone freaked out after witnessing the true power of Tobey Spidey being capable of producing his own web was spectacular. So once our spider squad have prepared their vaccines for the Sinister Five, oh, I forgot to mention that Octavius was the only one who Peter had the chance to administer the COVID vaccine shot in his apartment before the situation got out of hand. Now that I think about the sublime messages of this film, I think the Spider Squad represents the pro-vaccination community and the antagonists are the anti-vaxxers who refuse to take the shot because it is still at an experimental stage. I'm reading too much into it. It's probably the alcohol. This is a Marvel movie after all. There are no subliminal messages in it, right? Yeah, it's definitely the alcohol. Probably need to make this video sober. Where were we? Ah, yeah. Our Spider Squad is ready to take on the Sinister Five. A great battle erupts. Our heroes manage to prevail. Sandman, Electro and Lizard are cured. And Green Goblin is the last man standing. Oh, meanwhile, during the fight scene, Ned accidentally frees Doctor Strange from the Mirror Dimension by opening a very convenient portal to their location.
Well, that's just lazy writing.
I'll give them that. So while the Spider Bros are playing the nurses, Strange basically keeps the multiverses from turning into mashed potatoes and prevents other bad guys from crossing into their universe. And now the final fight between Goblin and Petya, it has a lot of weight. His raging hatred towards the man that killed his aunt lets him loose, he doesn't hold back, and ends up almost killing Osborn with his own glider until he is interrupted by Tobey's Spider-Man. Norman finds the chance to backstab Tobey. Then Andrew passes the serum to Tom, who in turn injects it into Osborn's neck. Alas, the victory is bittersweet and short-lived. As Strange struggles to close the multiversal bridge, Petya suggests wiping out everybody's memory of him so that they can prevent further calamity, to which the Sorcerer Supreme agrees to. Petya shares a brief sentimental moment with MJ before her memory of him disappears forever, and he bids farewell to Tobey and Andrew before they get dusted back to their own universes. The spell is successful, the world is saved. In conclusion, I wanna give praise to Holland, Dafoe and Andrew Garfield for putting incredible performances. Also, I can't wait to see what else Sony has in store for us, as there are rumors from what I heard about Andrew returning to reprise his role in the future. His redemption arc and the emotional save of MJ falling from Statue of Liberty was done so well. If you enjoyed this video, ladies and gentlemen, hit the like button, subscribe and hit the notification bell for whenever I upload next. Probably next year. Here's to you, my friends. Yuri out.